Raf-Seidel method. The next method is Newton-Raphson method. The next method is Newton-Raphson.
So next we go for the Newton-Raphson method. Okay. So the Newton-Raphson technique, it is again one more numerical method to solve the nonlinear simultaneous quadratic equations. Okay. So let us take a simple function to understand Newton-Raphson method. Say x square minus 4x plus 4 is equals to 0 is a function which we are trying to solve. Okay, let us assume we don't know the standard method we are using, the Newton-Raphson method, to solve this. So what is the solution? We are searching for that x value which will make this equation 0. So our f of x is equals to x square minus 4x plus 4. Okay, we are trying to find out that x value, which we substitute that one, we are going to get f of x equal to 0. Okay, so it is based on the Taylor's theorem. It is based on the Taylor's theorem. Initially, what we are assuming, that initial guess value, initial guess value is x naught value is, say, 0. We are starting with 0 guess value, and we are assuming that for this initial guess value, if we add some delta x, first increment value, delta x naught value, I am going to achieve my 0. I am going to achieve my solution. So I am hunting for that delta x naught value. Okay. You can say delta x one. First increment value, if you add that delta x, you are going to get that this one. Now, according to Taylor series, we can expand this one as f of x naught plus df by dx at x naught into delta x1 plus d square f by dx square at x0 into delta x1 square divided by 2 factorial, so on and so forth till infinity. So this value is going to become what? 0. If we neglect all higher order terms, we only consider the first two terms, so our solution is becoming what? 0 is equals to f of x naught plus df by dx at x naught into delta x1. So from this, how we are going to get the delta x1 value, which implies delta x1, the first increment value, is equals to minus f of x naught divided by df by dx at x naught value. Df by dx at x naught value. So this will give you the first increment. Okay. So again, what you do, you will calculate the x1. First iteration value is equals to 0th iteration value plus the first increment. First increment. Delta x1. Okay. So from this, you are going to get the first iteration value. Again, you check whether this f of x1 is equals to 0 or not. If it is 0, then you have got your solution. If it is not 0, then again you go for the second iteration. So for second iteration, again you compute the second increment value. Delta x2 value, you are going to calculate it as minus f of x1 divided by df by dx at x1. Okay, then you are going to get the second increment value. Again, once you get the second increment value, your x2 is going to become x1 plus delta x2. This is your new value. Again, you check whether it has achieved the solution or not. So like this way, you will repeat until you achieve the solution. So a beautiful example we can show here. first you see, it is calculating from the x value, it is calculating the slope of tangent. Then again, it is going for the second one. So like this, within 3-4 iterations, you are going to achieve the solution. Okay. So if you want to explain this curve, what we are doing here? First, we are starting with a guess value. Suppose this is our guess value. This is x-axis. This is f of x. We are starting with a guess value x naught. Okay. From that x naught, this is f of x naught. From f of x naught, you calculate slope of tangent. If you calculate, it will cut the x-axis at someone. So this one will be your first iteration value. And this difference is delta x1. Okay. Again, from there, again, what you do, you calculate the f of x2, and again you calculate the slope of tangent. The slope of tangent for this value will cut at this value. This is your second iteration value, x2. So again you do it. So by the third iteration, you are going to achieve the solution. Okay. This is a graphical method which explains how the solution is achieved. Okay. So here, if you now observe, first you calculate slope of tangent, then again you calculate slope of tangent, again you calculate slope of tangent. So within maximum 3 to 5 iterations, you will achieve the convergence. You will achieve the convergence.
Okay, sir.
Well, let us do one problem. Okay. This is our problem, and we are trying to solve by using Newton-Raphson method. Let us have a guess value as x naught as 0. Okay. How you get the first increment value, delta x1, first increment value is given by minus f of x naught into df by dx at x naught value. So substitute the x naught equal to 0, what you're going to get? You're going to get 4. F of x naught value is how much? 4. Because you're directly substituting 0. If you differentiate f of x, what you're going to get? 2x minus 4. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
2x minus 4. Again, you substitute x naught value. How much you're going to get? Minus 4. Yes, how much you're going to get? Minus 4.
Okay.
So what is the increment value? Minus 1. So your next iteration value will become, x1 value will become x0 plus delta x1. So what is this value? Minus 1. This value is minus 1. Okay. Now we'll try to calculate the second value. X2 is equals to minus f of x1 divided by df by dx at x1 value. So now you substitute the x1 value, what you're going to get? One value, 1 minus 1 minus of 1 is 1 plus 4 minus 9, and again you differentiate and substitute, what value you're getting? That is 2x minus 4. In this value, if you substitute x is equals to minus 1, what you're going to get? 2 into minus 1, minus 4, it is
minus 6.
So what is this increment value?
1.5.
So your x2 value will become minus 1 plus 1.5. How much? 0.5. Okay. Again, you do the iteration. Again, you do the iteration. So you are... to get the next increment value delta x3, what you got to do? Minus f of x2 divided by df by dx at x2 value. So if you again do this one, what you're going to get? You're going to get some value. Okay. Like this, you continue the iteration. Within 5 to 7 steps, you're going to get the solution. Okay.
Okay, sir.
You do this same problem, you continue. It will take 30 to 40 minutes or 20 minutes if you are fast, good at numbers, you'll get the solution. Okay. Newton-Raphson method for multivariable functions. Multivariable functions. Let us take a function f of 1, which is a function of two variables, say x comma y. X comma y. There is one more function which is a variable of again x comma y. So now we have to solve both these functions f1 and f2 simultaneously such that this should be satisfied. That is our object. We have to find out the x and y values which satisfy both the equations. Which satisfy both the equations. Again, what we do, we go for the guess values. Guess values. Let us call x0 comma y0 is equals to 0 comma 0 is our guess values. 0 comma 0 are the guess values. Then again, by using the Taylor series, what you are going to get? F1 of x0 plus delta x1 comma y0 plus delta y1 is equals to f1 of x0 y0 plus df1 by dx1 at x0 y0 into delta x1 by 1 factorial plus df1 by dy1 at x0 y0 into delta y1 by into delta y1 by 1 factorial, so on and so forth. You will get higher order terms. Similarly, f2 of x0 plus delta x1 comma y0 plus delta y1 is equals to f2 of x0 y0 plus df2 by dx1 at the initial values, that is x0 y0 into delta x1 by 1 factorial plus df2 by dy2 at x0 y0 value into delta y1 by 1 factorial, so on and so forth. Okay, we are assuming that by adding those increments, we are achieving the solutions. We are achieving the solution. That is, this value is equals to 0. So from that, what you are going to get? You are going to get minus f1. Instead of writing every time x0, y0, I am writing 0th iteration values. Minus f2 into 0th iteration values is equals to, we can directly write df1 by dx1, df1 by dy1, df2 by dx1, df2 by dy1 into 0th iteration value. Again, I am substituting the 0th iteration value into the increments are delta x1, delta y1. Okay, this will be your thing. Okay, you do, in order to obtain the increments, this is the matrix form you are going to get. So this value, this matrix is called mismatch matrix. Mismatch matrix. This is called Jacobian matrix. This is called increment matrix. Increment vector, sorry. Mismatch vector. Jacobian matrix and increment vector. So when we'll stop the convergence, when these values become exactly zero, then our iteration will be stopped. So to get the new guess values for multivariable function, what we are going to do, delta x1 delta y1 is equals to Jacobian matrix with initial guess values whole inverse into minus f1 naught minus f2 naught. So we are going to get the increment values, first increment values. Then after getting the first increment values, what you are going to do? You get the x0 plus delta x1, y1 is equals to x, y0 plus delta y1 naught delta y1. Okay, like this you get the first guess values, you check whether they have converged or not. If they have not converged, again you do the same exercise. Again you do the same exercise. Second iteration, again what you do, you again calculate this one minus f1 first iteration value minus f2 of first iteration value is equals to df1 by dx1, df1 by dy1, df2 by dx2, df2 by dy1. Not this is x1 into first iteration values into delta x2 value and delta y2 value, second increment values. So like this you calculate increments and you go for the next iteration. Okay, so the iterations are very complex. In Gauss-Seidel method, every iteration is very complex, but the advantage is that you will get the convergence very quickly. Okay, so for a single variable you get only one equation, for multivariable you get the Jacobian matrix. So important points which you have to remember in the Newton-Raphson method is each iteration is complex. Okay, second one is number of iterations for convergence, is less, maximum 3 to 5. In 3 to 5 it will converge. The third is very important question is size of Jacobian matrix. Is equals to number of variables in iteration. Multiplied by number of variables in iteration. Okay. So the size of Jacobian matrix is equals to number of variables in iteration multiplied by number of variables in iteration. So here you can observe how many variables, how many unknown variables are there. Two unknown variables are there. So the size is 2 into 2. Size of Jacobian matrix is 2 into 2. Okay. So once you know unknown variables in the iteration, then you can easily calculate the size of Jacobian matrix. Okay. So these are some features of the Newton-Raphson method. Each iteration is complex. Number of iterations for convergence is very less, 3 to 5. The size of Jacobian matrix is equals to number of variables in iterations multiplied by number of variables in iteration. Okay. So the convergence is quadratic. Very fast convergence in Newton-Raphson method. Okay. So this is about Newton-Raphson method. Now, very important is comparison between Newton-Raphson and Gauss-Seidel method. We will do the comparison. Okay, the first point is here each iteration is simple. Whereas in Newton-Raphson method, each iteration is complex. Okay. Here in Gauss-Seidel, guaranteed but slow convergence. Okay. Here the convergence is linear, but means slow, linear convergence in Gauss-Seidel. here the convergence is quadratic convergence. Okay. Wrong slack bus selection. If you select the wrong bus as slack bus, wrong slack bus selection will affect convergence. Whereas here, even for wrong slack bus selection, convergence will be achieved. Convergence will get the convergence. Okay, Gauss Seidel is suitable for small power system networks. That means networks with less number of buses. This is suitable for any power system, small or big. It is suitable for any power system network. So here accuracy is less. In Gauss Seidel, accuracy is less, whereas Newton-Raphson is more accurate. Understand? The second one here is programming is easy because mathematical equations are simple. Programming is easy, whereas here programming is difficult. Coding is difficult. Okay. Initial guess values affect rate of convergence. Initial guess values affect rate of convergence. Independent of initial guess values. Wherever you choose your initial guess values, it will converge within 3 to maximum 7 iterations. Independent of initial guess values. Okay. So these are different points between the Gauss Seidel and Newton-Raphson method. The last one is, in Gauss Seidel, rectangular coordinates are preferred. Newton-Raphson, you prefer polar coordinates are preferred. Understand? So these are the differences between the Gauss Seidel and Newton-Raphson method. Newton-Raphson method is accurate, fast, but these are the advantages. It is accurate and fast. Okay. And slack bus selection, initial guess values will not affect the convergence. But whereas Gauss Seidel method is slow, initial guess values and slack bus selection will affect the convergence. Okay. But the advantage is programming is easy. Whereas here programming is difficult. Okay. So these are the differences between the Gauss Seidel and Newton-Raphson methods. Okay. We can directly go for the size of Jacobian matrix. Okay. So size of Jacobian matrix is given by 2 into n minus 1 minus m into 2 into n minus 1 minus m. So where this value is fixed, where n is number of buses in power system network, m is number of voltage controlled buses, PV buses or generator buses. Okay. So if you know these values, you can directly tell the size of Jacobian matrix. Okay. So all those concepts which we have discussed in Gauss-Seidel method are equally applicable. Equally applicable. Okay. The size of Jacobian matrix is given by 2 into n minus 1 minus m into 2 into n minus minus m, where n is the number of buses in power system network, where m is the number of voltage controlled buses or PV buses. Why? Because every load bus has two variables. What are those two variables we have seen? One is voltage magnitude and load angle. So every load bus has two variables. Every PV or generator bus or voltage control bus has one variable. What is that variable? Only load angle, delta, because we know the magnitude of voltage. Slack bus has zero variables. Slack bus has zero variables. Why? Because we already know mod V1 and delta 1 values. So that is the basic idea for the number of variables that are in the iteration. So every load bus will contribute two variables. PV bus will contribute only one variable, that is voltage angle, because voltage magnitude is known. Slack bus has zero variables. Understand? So this is about the Newton-Raphson and Gauss-Seidel method. The next one is, there are again the other versions of Newton-Raphson method. They are called decoupled load flow analysis. So decoupled load flow analysis, what they treat is, they do is, so your Jacobian matrix, let us take for a Jacobian matrix for a two bus system will be 4 into 4. Okay. So I am writing just the Jacobian matrix for a 2x2 system. That is, let us assume a 3-bus system where first bus is a slack bus, remaining 2-3 buses are PQ buses or load buses. So then the Jacobian matrix size, it will become dou P2 by dou delta 2. Okay. Dou P2 by dou delta 3. Dou P2 by dou mod V2. Dou P2 by dou mod V3. Dou P3 by dou delta 2. Dou P3 by dou delta 3. Dou P3 by dou mod V2. Dou P3 by dou mod V3. Like this, you get dou Q2 by dou delta 2. Dou Q2 by dou delta 3. Dou Q2 by dou mod V2. Dou Q2 by dou mod V3. Okay. Next, dou Q3 by dou delta 2. Dou Q3 by dou delta 3. Dou Q3 by dou mod V3, mod V2. Dou Q3 by dou mod V3. So this is my Jacobian matrix. The unknown variables for two load buses is delta delta 2, delta delta 3, delta mod V2, delta mod V3. And your power mismatch matrix will be like this. P2 minus P2 naught, P3 minus P3 naught, Q2 minus Q2 naught, Q3 minus Q3 naught. So for a 3x3 matrix, this is the size of your Jacobian matrix. Okay. So here you can observe, first rectangle, the first four elements, if you divide into this one, here the variation of power with respect to delta, dou P by dou delta, dou P by dou delta. Here it is dou P by dou mod magnitude of voltage. Here dou Q by dou delta, here is dou Q by dou If you remember our power flow equations, your power that is flowing from bus 1 to bus 2, from one bus to another bus, is given by mod V1 into mod V2 divided by mod X into sine delta. Similarly, reactive power is given by mod V2 by mod X into mod V1 cos delta minus mod V2. I'm simply writing bus 1 and 2. So, real power flow is highly sensitive to variations of delta. Real power flow is highly sensitive to variations of delta, but negligibly sensitive to variations of voltage magnitude. Okay, so based upon this point, since the real power flow is highly sensitive to variations of delta and it is negligibly sensitive to variations of magnitude, so what we can treat for all practical purpose, dou P by dou mod V, we are making it as zero. We are neglecting the variations of real power flow with respect to variations of magnitude of voltage. Okay. Second, if you observe in the second term, reactive power flow is highly sensitive to variations of voltage magnitude and it is negligibly sensitive to variations of delta. So again, if I make dou Q by dou delta is equals to zero, because reactive power flow is highly sensitive to variations of voltage magnitude and it is negligibly sensitive to variations of load angle or voltage angle. So if I incorporate these two approximations in my Newton-Raphson method, the one which I am getting is called decoupled load flow. So that means if you make all the terms dou P by dou mod V terms as zero and dou Q by dou delta terms as zero, so you are going to get what? This complete matrix will become zero. And this complete matrix will become zero. So here the number of calculations are reduced by half. That's why it's called decoupled load flow analysis. Where we are assuming the variations of real power with respect to variations of voltage magnitudes are neglected. Variations of reactive power flow with respect to variations of load angle are neglected. Okay. So by doing this in the original Newton-Raphson method, we are going to get the decoupled load flow analysis. So what is the advantage? Advantage is it is faster than original Newton-Raphson method, because half of the calculations are reduced. So definitely the convergence will be very fast. I mean, the time taken to solve the load flow problem will be very less. Okay. What is the disadvantage? Some accuracy is lost, because whenever you do some approximation, some accuracy is lost. Okay. So when you want very quick solution, the time is a criteria, then you can go for the decoupled load flow analysis. So there is one more thing called fast decoupled load flow analysis. So here what do they do? FDLF, fast decoupled load flow analysis. Here not only the above two expressions, that is in original Newton-Raphson method, we incorporate following approximations. Okay, following approximations. What are those? Dou P by dou mod v is 0 that we have already taken. Dou q by dou delta is 0 that also we have taken. We also neglect series resistance of transmission line. So if you neglect series resistance of transmission line, what will happen? Your Z value will become transfer admittance, that is Z12 will become only reactants 0 plus J X12. Your admittance will become Y12. Let us write it will become only susceptance minus J into B12. That means when I wrote YIK is equals to GIK plus GIK minus BIK, what you are getting? When you approximate this value is equals to 0, your susceptance will become infinity. So your YIK will become only minus J into BIK. Your GIK will become 0. And your gamma IK will become minus 90 degrees. Okay. So if you make your GIK equal to 0 and gamma IK equal to 90 in along with above two approximations, then you are going to get the fast decoupled load flow analysis. This will again make it very fast convergence. It will again make it very fast convergence. Understand? So what assumptions we are making in fast decoupled load flow analysis? We are neglecting the series resistance. The impact is your GIK in your bus admittance matrix. Your GIK terms are becoming 0 and your gamma IK value is directly, you are getting it as minus 90 degrees. So with even the fast, even it will take lesser time to achieve the convergence. Okay, it is the fastest, but the accuracy will be again going. Again, we are making more approximation, means our accuracy will be lost. Okay, so this is about the load flow analysis. We'll take few questions and we'll close the topic for today. So how do we model loads the load connected at a bus in the load flow analysis? We model our loads as the constant real and reactive power demanding loads. We model our loads as the constant real and reactive power demanding loads. This is one of the assumptions which we made while we started the load flow analysis. If you go back and see lecture one, you're going to get this point. We model our loads as the constant real and reactive power demanding loads. Understand? Yeah. Read this question. The Gauss Seidel load flow method has the following disadvantages. Tick the incorrect statement. The Gauss Seidel load flow method has the following disadvantages. Tick the incorrect statement. Tell what is the incorrect statement out of this?
A or D, sir?
Incorrect statement. Yes, Gauss Seidel method has slow convergence. This is correct. Choice of slog bits affects the convergence. It is also correct. A good initial guess value is essential for convergence. It is also correct. But it is a reliable convergence. If it is unreliable, why we use it? Yes, guaranteed convergence, but slow convergence. So unreliable convergence is the incorrect statement. It has reliable convergence, slow convergence, but reliable convergence. Yes, the choice of slack bits affects convergence and good initial guess values are required for the convergence. Unreliable convergence is the wrong option. Wrong option. Okay. Now, the next question is, for a 15 bus power system, 3 voltage control buses are there. The size of Jacobian matrices. The size of Jacobian matrices. That is a question. So the size of Jacobian matrix is 2 into n minus 1 minus n. Into 2 into n minus 1 minus n. Okay. The entire trick lies in calculating m. Here you know what is n value. N value is how much? 15. No problem. What is the m value? What is the m value? Okay. So remember one thing, every generator bus is a voltage control bus. Okay, so if there are three voltage control buses, they may be generator buses, voltage control buses, they can be anything. But out of three, one must be slack bus. So here, three voltage controlled buses are there, or they may be called as PV or generator buses. Out of which, definitely one bus must be slack bus. Okay, so then how many you take the slack bus out, then how many voltage control buses are there? Then your M value will become not 3 but 2. You always have to omit the slack bus. Understand? So your M value will become 2. Number of voltage control buses without slack bus is 2. So then your Jacobian size matrix will become 2 into 15 minus 1 minus 2 into the same value. So what is this value? 2 into 14 minus 2. How much is this value? 14. 26 is coming up. So here he has forgotten the slack bus. Actually, he should tell 15 bus power system has 3 voltage control buses and 1 slack bus. He should write that sentence. Otherwise, student and 1 slack bus. So in that case, we can directly write our M as 3. So if you substitute M is equal to 3, you are going to get how much? 25 would be the wrong, right option. Okay. Remember, always you should omit slack bus. You should omit the slack bus from the number of voltage control buses. Here the question is wrong. You should have given 15 bus system will have 3 voltage control buses and 1 slack bus. Then the option would have been correct. Read this question. In the solution of load flow equation, Newton-Raphson method is superior to Gauss-Seidel method because why the Newton-Raphson method is superior to Gauss-Seidel method? Tell me which is the right option?
B,
out
sir.
Of four.
B, B, option B, sir. B, B. Number of iterations required in the end. Sorry, sir. It is less than Gauss-Seidel method, sir.
D is the right option. Yes, from the given options, the right option is convergence characteristics of Newton-Raphson method are not affected by the selection of slack bus. Okay, so out of these four options, D is the right option. Because time taken for one iteration in Newton-Raphson method is more, Newton-Raphson method will take more time for every iteration when compared to Gauss-Seidel method. This is wrong. The number of iterations required for Newton-Raphson method is less when compared to the Gauss-Seidel method. The number of iterations required is independent of size of this one. Okay. Whatever may be the size, the Newton-Raphson method will take only fixed iteration, that is 3 to 7 maximum. So out of these four options, D will be the correct option. So load flow studies involve, load flow studies involve solving simultaneous. What are the equations? Our expression for PI, QI, and VI, they are simultaneous nonlinear algebraic equations. All our equations which we get in our load flow are the simultaneous nonlinear algebraic equations. Okay. Next, again, find out the number of simultaneous equations that are to be solved by using Newton-Raphson. So you remember, number of equations for each iteration in Newton-Raphson method is same as number of variables in the iteration.
means the number of equations that we are solving for every iteration is same as number of variables, that is 2 into n minus minus. That value is 2 into n minus 1 minus n. Okay. So now tell the answer for this question. A 183 bus power system has 150 PQ buses, 32 PV buses. In general case, to obtain load flow solution by using Newton-Raphson method in polar coordinates, the minimum number of simultaneous equations to be solved are, okay, you have to calculate this one. So total buses is 183. Okay, total load buses, PQ buses are 150. PV buses are 32. So one is missing. So he has slack bus is one. Slack bus is one. So if you add 150, 32 plus 1, you are going to get 183. So he has separated the slack bus. So directly you can write your m value here is 32. So number of equations will become 2 into 183 minus 1 minus 32. This value will be the answer. So what is the option?
332
equations. Okay. If they ask the size of Jacobian matrix, it will be 332 into 332. Okay. So here he clearly mentioned that one slack bus is separated. Total is not matching with 183. So one bus will be the slack bus. Okay. Now we'll go for the left out questions. A power system contains two areas, area 1 and area 2, connected by a tie line. Suppose this is area 1. Maybe this is Tamil Nadu Electricity Board, TANGEDCO. And this is a tie line. This is a Kerala State Electricity Board. So there are two individual power systems. They can operate on their own, but however they are connected with a line. So whenever two individual power systems are connected, that particular transmission line is called tie line. Okay, that particular transmission line is called tie line. Okay, so once this tie line exists, we can treat this entire power system as a single power system network. So once the tie line is accurate, then we can treat this entire as one power system. So for this one, you can get only one slack bus is required. Okay, if the tie line somehow is left out, if you leave this tie line, then they will be separated into two power systems. So for each one, you require one slack bus. You require separate slack bus for each of them. So with this data, you tell me what is the right. So he has said while entering the data in computer for solving load flow problem, what he has done, the tie line data is left out. The tie line data connecting parameters are inadvertently left out. Mistakenly, he has forgotten the tie line data. Okay. Now, the load flow program is run without the tie line data. Then what will happen? The load flow will converge only if the slack bus is specified in area 1? No. If the slack bus is specified in only in area 2? No. Load flow problem will converge if the slack bus is specified in either area 1 or area 2. No, the slack bus will only converge when you have the load flow will only converge if you have two separate slack buses for area 1 and area 2. The load flow problem will not converge if only one slack bus is specified. That is the right option. Because now you have disconnected the tie line, you have left out the tie line data. So the problem will converge only when you have two separate slack buses for this one. So load flow will not converge if only one slack bus is specified. Option D is the right option. Option D is the right option. Okay. Last problem. Here, the total buses are 300. Okay. Total generator buses are 20. Buses with reactive power support buses are 25. Okay. Buses with fixed shunt capacitor, 50. Remaining all are load buses. So what are the remaining buses if you subtract 15, 25, 20? Remaining all are load buses. Gentlemen, here one and only two important points which you have to remember. Out of 20 generator buses, one will be slack bus, Q slack bus. Remaining 19 are generator buses. Generator buses. Okay. Even all the buses that are having reactive power support, they also classify as PV buses. PV buses are voltage controlled buses. Voltage controlled buses. See, the buses with shunt inductor, shunt capacitor also classify as voltage controlled buses. But however, once you fix their capacity, then it will act as a load bus. Very, very, very important point. So, once you fix the capacity of shunt capacitor, shunt inductor, or any VAR generator, it will act as a load bus. It will act as a load bus. Very, very important. Had they removed the word fixed, then it would have qualified as a voltage control bus. Had the fixed word has been omitted, then it would have qualified as a voltage control bus. So now we have to treat this fixed shunt capacitors as load bus. So from this data, what you are going to get? Calculate the number of voltage control buses. The number of voltage control buses. In the initial, there are 19. And then there are 25. So M value is equals to how much? 44. M value is equals to 44. Now you substitute in the formula, you are going to get 2 into 300 minus 1. What is the formula? 2 into N minus 1 minus M into the same value. 300 minus 1 minus 44. So what is this value? This value will become 598 minus
54.
554 is the right option. 554 into 554 is the right option. Remember, had they used the only shunt capacitors or shunt inductors or synchronous phase modifier something, they directly qualify as voltage control buses. But once you fix their value, they will act as the load buses. They will act as the load buses. Okay, gentlemen. So with this, we'll stop this lecture. There are